I want to thank you for watching Soul Food Ministry on this program. And I hope you will join me whenever our program comes on the cable and, of course, on radio as well. I've said often, and I think I heard other people say this, that a preacher who does not have a library can be compared to a doctor who does not have a stethoscope. The stethoscope measures the pulse that goes through the body. The Bible and the books in his library will help to measure the spiritual life of men and women in our community whom we have been called to minister to. This is not a boast or anything, but I thank God for my pastor, Reverend Richard C. Maddox, who impressed upon me the fact that the minister does need to have a library, and that library should be composed of books that will help you to understand the New Testament, as well as books that will help you to understand the Old Testament. And then we need to read and to pray and to ask God for wisdom, even as we prepare our ministry of the Word of God to people in today's world. A lot of men have written scholarly information. That information is available to us today to help us to try to understand the text of Scripture as we seek God's will and God's counsel for men and women in today's world. God bless you really good. Thank you for watching the SOS, the Ministry of Southern Heights Baptist Church on this particular station.
Yeah. I don't want to be pushing up dandelions, huh? No, this is good. Tim, you're not going to have enough to tape all of it because the sermon will probably be long enough, so you can stop in there.
Yes.
And my salvation, the Lord is my light. And my salvation, the Lord is my light. And my salvation, whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? The Ooh.
And the people of God said, amen, and praise the Lord, and give him the glory, for his name is to be praised. Thank you so much for those songs. Thank you for reading the word this morning. I want to indicate that I want to do something a little bit different this morning. Turn your attention to the bulletin. That we read, but also coming from your Bible, in the verses that we cited. This is the day which the Lord has made, and we rejoice, and we're glad in it. With your Bible open, heart alert to the things of God, and with sins confessed, and asking God to forgive you for anything that may block or hinder him from allowing you the privilege of being his servant today. Amen? Because that's the only way we're going to grow in grace, because as I learned in Sunday school, the Baptist School of the Bible, this book will keep you from sin, or sin will keep you from the book. They don't go together. Amen? I have been speaking on the church, and there is no greater subject that one can mention. And from your bulletin this morning, we read the information found on the church in the book of Ephesians. But I want to spend time with you and to show you how transitions come about when you read the Bible, and how you can better understand the scriptures as you note those transitions. As they come about, we normally don't pay any attention to them. Would somebody bring my Greek text from up there? I think I left it up there. And I've got some notes in it. Now, the book of Ephesians is the book on the church. Dr. Homer Kent wrote a book on Ephesians, and it is the book that deals with the church. Yes, I just need this. Let me put it down here. Right. It is the book on the church. And what I want to do here this morning is to go over this information with you. And notice what happens when the word church appears in the book of Ephesians. I'm a little bit filled with papers and all that good stuff, because this is a good subject. It's a wonderful subject. Whatever you do, stay on terms with the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right? First thing that we want to make note of, in addition to what we read this morning in your bulletin, we have the time when the church is mentioned in the book of Ephesians. It's mentioned in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 20. And going down through verse 23. And you may mark your bulletin if you hold your Bible to be so sacred that you can't write in it. Mine is not like that. I scribble in mine. But be careful how you scribble in your Bible if you don't have a marker that you can use. What you want to do is to be able to come back to this and to point out some things in your own life as you live for the Lord Jesus Christ. So, Ephesians chapter 1 in your bulletin, and beginning at verse 20, it's talking about the work of Christ, what he did for us. God sent him to be our Savior. He is our Lord and he is our Master. And when we notice the word church appearing here, and it appears a number of times in this book, but it's good to notice the context in which the word appears. Always when you study your Bible, you don't just read something from the Bible and then try to figure out what it's talking about. When you're going to interpret the scripture, context, context, context is all that you really need to know. And what do you mean by context? What was said before, what was said about it here, and what is said about it in its kind of immediate context. You grab a text of scripture. Jesus did this. He went to Luke chapter 4 and verse 18, and he's preaching from the book of Isaiah chapter 61 and verse 1. And he lifts that one verse out and explains the verse. That's what preaching is supposed to be all about. It's not about shouting or hooping or running or trying to be emotional. When you see what Jesus did in the teaching of the Word of God, he grabbed the text and he explained the text to the people. And as they understood the text, they got the voice of God coming through that text saying, this is what God wants us to do. That happened, and I will be speaking on Tuesday on this whole subject, and prepared to deal with it today, but I don't want to. That's not the subject. But whenever you find a text of scripture, you have to see what is it talking about in the midst of that text. For instance, I can't give you the everything here in the book of Ephesians, but you can figure out something. Look at Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 20. Which he wrought in Christ. What do we mean by wrought? Which he performed, which he worked in Christ, which he dispersed his energy in Christ. So Jesus Christ is the most important person in all of the world, all of the world. Who then is Christ? Now look at what he says here. As he kind of identifies him, verse 19 says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. Now, where do you find the workings of God's mighty power? You find it in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, he was God, he is God, he's co-equal with God in every possible way. Notice what he says in verse 20. Which he worked in Christ when he, where is the resurrection, where is the mighty power of God displayed upon this earth? When Jesus Christ got up from the dead, and here's the unique thing, he raised himself. Now, dead man just doesn't put life back into his body. Why? Because he's dead. So, what do we have here? I think I'm standing under the mic there. What do we have here? Jesus, being God, brought himself back from the dead. Now, if you find a dead man who can sit up in his casket and say, "Now, I think I'm going to wake up," you better get out of there. Because something's wrong with that. But Jesus, as a dead man, puts life back into himself, and he arose from the dead. This is a display of God's mighty power in the life of an individual. I don't know, but this kind of sticks in my mind as I watched television last week, and there was a program on by a false teacher. Name was Jim Jones. You all have heard about him. He claimed to be a prophet of God, and he led his people to the point where they trusted him, and he told them, "Drink the poison," and they drank the poison. For a number of times, there was no poison in it. But then finally, he comes out, "Drank the poison. Yeah, you have 10 minutes to live." You see, Jesus Christ is real, and his mighty power has also been displayed in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. So this word is mentioned in relationship to the church. Notice what it says. He raised him from the dead and seated him at his own right hand. Now, what is the importance of him being seated? We noticed this morning, as we talked about the Davidic kingdom, this kingdom that God said, "I'm going to establish it in David, and I will never, ever overturn the Davidic kingdom." The power of God working through the nation of Israel as he made a covenant with David in 2 Samuel chapter 7, and beginning at verse 14 and going down through verse 16, God says, "My kingdom will never come to an end in David." And I want to tell you something. The Davidic kingdom has not yet been fulfilled. There was that intermission. And believe me, there was no such thing as the cessation of the church, of the nation of Israel. Israel has not been succeeded. Israel is still in unbelief. Read it in Romans 11. Israel is still blind, although Israel has been grafted into, the church has been grafted into Israel. The church has not replaced the nation of Israel. It never will. It's just that Israel has not come to faith in Jesus Christ, and they do not know that they are following a blind Savior. When Jesus comes back and the world turns to Christ and confess their sins and acknowledge that they killed the Messiah, they killed the Prince of Peace, and open their heart to Jesus Christ, then Israel will be born again and the Davidic kingdom will continue its fulfillment, but that will happen in the millennial reign of Christ. Okay, I don't want to get off on this one, but what I'm saying is that it is the resurrection of Christ where God seated him at his own right hand. Now, what's the significance of Jesus being seated in heaven? What happened to the Old Testament priest? Year after year, on the Day of Atonement, when they went into the holy place, the most holy place in the tabernacle and in the temple, what did they do? They killed the lamb. They took his blood and they sprinkled it on the mercy seat. And then the priest left, but he never sat down in the holy place. Why? Because their work was not done. They went in, they made the offering, they sprinkled the blood, they came out, but they never sat down. But what about the Lamb of God? When he went into the most holy place, when he entered into heaven itself, what did he do once he made that offering in Hebrews chapter 10 and 11? He sat down. And what's the significance of him seated? His sacrifice was complete. The work of redemption was accomplished. There was no need for the Lamb of God to stand anymore because he had accomplished the mission that God had for him. Are you with me this morning? So, Ephesians chapter 1 mentions the church in this context. What is the job of the church? What is it that we're supposed to preach and teach? We are supposed to preach that Jesus Christ now, having been dead, but now alive from the dead, has offered the ultimate sacrifice for the sins of a rebellious world. And now he is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. You see him standing up in the book of Acts when Stephen, of course, was stoned to death. You see. But here he is, seated at the right hand of the throne of God. And never again does he come back and redo that work. If you're having trouble with believing that what God has done is final, it's over, your security is certain, here is one verse that tells us that Jesus is alive from the dead, he is risen from the dead, he sat down, he's now at the right hand of the throne of God, and his work is done. His work is done. Amen. Romans 8 and 30 through 30, oh, 6 or 7. You'll see, I'm persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angel, nor principality, nor power, nor any other spirit is able to separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Amen? You can throw your arms around him and say, I don't care what I did yesterday, and Lord, I don't want to offend you today. If I'm doing anything wrong, show it to me that I may confess my sins and turn away from it, because I want to please you in my life. So that's the first time. But I want you to notice something else here in this context where he mentions the church. Set him down at his own right hand. What is the significance of Jesus being at God's right hand? Why not at his left hand? He's seated at his right hand. And the right hand, for those of us who are right-handed, that's the place of power. It's the place of authority. It's a place of success. Jesus is seated at God's right hand. And we know that, as Athanasius pointed out, this black dwarf man who lived in the 3rd century A.D. and pointed out the doctrines that we preach and teach today. Same doctrine. That Jesus Christ is the same as God. That the Holy Spirit is the same as Jesus Christ and the Father. And Athanasius hammered that doctrine out, and he was a black man who lived in North Africa, a scholar who was exiled from his church many, many times and persecuted because he believed that what the text of the Word of God says, that's what God stands behind. Amen? And it's no different from us today. But look at him. Seated him in heavenly places. Now, I want you to notice verse 21. What is the meaning of that word far? What do you mean by far above? There are some people today who are afraid of angels. They believe in ghosts and spirits and all that stuff. But I want to tell you here, according to this text, the church is supposed to preach that Jesus is above principalities. How many of you are afraid of the devil? Yeah? There was a time when I had a radio program on WBCL at night, and I'd come in here on Saturday nights and walk through this building, and the thought would come to me, man, oh man, you may be walking in the midst of demons. There's no demon that can touch you if you are in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. For Jesus Christ is far above. I want you to notice what it says here. All. As somebody has said, all means all, and that is all that all means. There may be cases where you can make an exception to it. But Jesus Christ is seated above all principalities. What do you mean, principalities? Every evil and demonic and wicked spirit that has ever been known, Jesus Christ is seated over them. This is for the church. If you're a member of this body called the Ecclesia, this called out body of believers in Christ, and that's God's program for today. Boy, that's a very interesting topic, and I don't want to jump off on it. But Jesus simply explained the text to people. Peter simply explained the text in Acts 15, I think it's 14, where Peter stood up and he said, God is calling out from among the Gentiles a people for his name. You can be a member of the church. You can be baptized and do all of those other good things, but if you have not been called out from among the Gentiles to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, to become a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, then something is off, brothers and sisters. And Peter said that this is God's program for today in Acts chapter 15 and verse 14. God is seeking a people for his name. Am I talking to myself? So, what is then the responsibility of the church? What is the job that God has assigned to you as believers in Christ? We talked just the other day about spiritual gifts. Amen? Don't you know that God has given to you the energy that you need to do whatever it is that God wants you to do? He doesn't call us and send us someplace and say, I ran out of juice. My gas gauge doesn't seem to be working right in my car. And my wife said to me this morning, did you put some gas in this car? I said, I'm on my way to the gas station now. As soon as I can get there, Lord knows I don't want to run out of gas, not in this kind of weather. God has never said to a Christian, I have called you and I have filled you with the Holy Spirit of God, but I've run out of gas for your engine. Yeah, God doesn't say that. Amen? He never has and he never will. Whatever God wants you to do, he will give you the power and the strength and the wisdom and the endurance to do it. And then after you do it, don't take the credit to yourself. Amen. That Doug Llewellyn used to say on this program, what was it called? The People's Court. He would say, if you got a problem that you can't solve, Don't take the law into your own hands. But what do? You take them to court. Now he's talking about a court down here. But I say, you take it to Jesus. Amen. You take it to the court that is ordained by God. And when you take it to a court ordained by God, God can make changes in your life, and God can change the situation and the circumstances. When you take him to court, appeal to God in prayer. Talk to him about the circumstances and the situation, and God is able to do something about it. Do you hear what I'm saying? God is able to do it. And I love this because it's talking about the church. It's talking about the role and ministry of the church. God has set Jesus Christ far above all principalities. In the book of Colossians, you know, they were afraid of angels. Angels would beat up on you and whip you if you didn't do what they wanted you to do. And Paul said, no. He bound the forces of wickedness. At Calvary, Jesus intercepted their authority and their power. They never did have any authority or power, but people thought that they had authority and power. Jesus triumphed in the cross over every evil and wicked and demonic spirit. Don't bite this thing about talking about what do they call it? Generational spirits. There's no such thing as generational spirit. Jesus has bound every wicked and evil and demonic spirit that has ever been named, and that spirit cannot come against the believers in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah, I have a generational spirit. Yeah, I love the Chewbacca. Yeah. I love to run around with women. That's a generational thing. I inherited from my daddy. No, you didn't. That's a selfish thing. That's something that you have not put on the altar for Jesus Christ to deal with in your life. I just talk, you know, child. I just love to gossip. That's the generational spirit. No, it's not. It's a selfish spirit. It's something that you just want to do in the flesh. That's all. We don't have generational spirits today. Jesus has bound every wicked and demonic spirit right here, and he bound them where? At Calvary. Talk about the hymns all you want to, but years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not that for me he died at Calvary. Amen? If you come to Calvary, you'll be released of these spirits that people bend and bow to. But we have power in the gospel. Amen? This dynamite of God that blows away all of these kind of things. He's talking about the church. That's what he's talking about. Notice what he goes on to say. He says in 21, far above all principality and power and might and dominion. And just in case there's anybody else, every name that is about to be named. And he uses a word here that's really a neat word. I learned it when I studied Greek under Dr. Wesley Garrick, and he made us study the Greek words in the text. And he says here, he uses the word meno. Every name that is about to be named. Can you think of other names? Every name that is about to be named, Christ is over them. He's just not a little idle God. He's not my elder brother. No, he's God, the second person of the Holy Trinity. All power and all authority is in his hand. Is not that what he said in Matthew 28, 19 and 20? Talk about going to Kenya or wherever else you want to go. If you're on the same wavelength with Jesus Christ, he can make it happen. Amen. As some people sing, and I don't think it's just a Pentecostal song, he can work it out. Yes, sir. If you have a problem, you can go to him in prayer. Amen. God can work it out. All power and all authority, every name that has ever been named, I don't care what you name him, Bush or Obama or Clinton, I don't care. Every name that has ever been named, Jesus is over those names. You don't understand what I'm saying here this morning. I don't want to hurt you. But Jesus Christ is above all. And really in this context, and it's talking about the context of the church, notice what it goes on to say. And he put, what?
All things.
How much of that all thing are you going to believe comprise the all things? Put it where? Boy, what a statement. Under his feet. And what did that symbolize for the Old Testament? When a king conquered the territory of another king or another enemy, he brought the chief leader to his throne, and he took his foot and he put his foot on the neck of the enemy. As the enemy would succumb to the authority and the power of the reigning king. You say, how do you know then that this is a transition that moves you from one point to another point? See, the book of Ephesians talks about at the first point, talks about God has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Are you a believer in Christ? Are you saved and born again? Has the Spirit of God opened your heart to the truth of the gospel? Then he says, I've given you everything that I have to give to you. And then there comes along this person and said, now, did you speak in tongues? Were you filled with the Holy Ghost when all of that thing happened? Well, you need to come back and be baptized in the name of Jesus. I'm not fussing with being baptized, and we know that Jesus has all authority invested in him. But the Bible says that he has given to us, in verse 3, he has blessed us with how many? Yes, bless God the Father who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Did it say anything about tearing for the Holy Ghost? Is that in the text? No. God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing, but where has he blessed us? in Christ. It would be good for you in your Bible study as you read it to just go through and put highlights around in Christ. Whatever God has for you, it comes to you in Christ. It doesn't come because of a job or an opportunity and all that stuff, and we all want good jobs, don't we? But your blessing, your spiritual life, is successful when you are in Christ. And when Christ reigns in your life, everything falls together for the glory of the Lord. Amen? It's Proverbs 3. What is it? 10? I believe it again. It is. Where God says, you should bring to the Lord the first fruit of your increase. And your barns will be full. And your presses will overflow with new wine. You submit to the Lord and allow him to reign in your life. Make Jesus Christ your number one king. Not your wife, not your husband. We're going to come to that because the book of Ephesians deals with that. He talks about here that marriage is a picture of the church. And these people who are at odds with one another, you know, want to fight and all that good stuff, all that bad stuff, rather. Jesus loved the church and gave himself for it. Notice what it says here. He put all things under his feet and gave him to be what? The head. Bore all things to the church. Let me tell you an attitude that we need to gather, that Christ is number one in my life, and I worship him and I honor him, I love him, and that Jesus is the head even of the church. Now, there are people arguing today about who's in charge of the church. What would you say?
Jesus.
It's stated a number of times right in the book of Ephesians. I'm not going to go into them, but we'll come down to them. But I'm talking about the church is the place that is the institution that God has put in this world, and God expects us to submit to the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, look at, if you will, as he goes on. He's the head over all things to the church. Please drive a peg in that. Because churches today are fighting. I'm in charge. You're not in charge. I'm the big pope. No. Bible says Christ is the head. And he gives us everything that we need to know. And as I voluntarily, as I talked, I believe it was last week, talking about this concept of the middle voice, and it's used in relationship as Christ is the head of the church, so let the wives be subject or subject herself to her own husband. So let the wives volunteer to be under the husband. That's what it says. It's a voluntary action. Amen?
Yes.
Now look at what it says here. He's the head of the church. All thanks to the church. Verse 23. Which is his, what? Verse 23. What is the church to Christ? His body. That's what it is. We are his body. He is the head. And what's the difference between the body and the head? In your head, what do you have? You have brain? Yeah, you have eyes, you have ears, you have a mouth. All comprised in the head. And what Jesus says ought to be happening in the church, take it to court. That's what Jesus wants. Amen. Well, I saw that, which is his body. And the body is the fullness of him who fills all in all. We are his church. We are his body. We are his eyes. We are his legs. We are, amen, his mouthpiece. Everything that ought to happen should be going on. The church is just a little miniature. Amen? Marriage. And we're going to see as we come down to Ephesians chapter 5, and kind of intended to go over there today, but I bite off for too much. When you get into this context thing, and you see what God is saying in the context, it brings a whole lot of other ramifications. There are these key articles, particles in the original text that says we're going from one transition to another one. Sometimes it's therefore. Sometimes it's wherefore. But you're moving from one end to another end as you think with the author through this book. And therefore, the Bible ought to be a book that we read and read it with all power and